A few words by way of introduction to our today's speaker. And by the way, we are very glad that we have you finally at our university. You were here in Holland some months ago doing a speaking tour, but then you could not visit the university. You did now, thanks to the Internationale Socialiste. And by the way, the main organizer is NIPI, Nederlands Instituut Palestina Israel. Yesterday, there was a spectacular event, in a way, at Instituut Klingendaal, where the speaker was invited to talk to an audience belonging to het Nederlands Genootschap voor Internationale Zaken, NGIZ. And the chairman of the meeting introduced the speaker as being on administrative leave from his job at De DePaul University in Chicago. And when the chairman said so, Norman Finkelstein looked up at him and said, "What do you mean, administrative leave? I'm unemployed. They fired me." So that's one. But why is he not working anymore at De DePaul University in Chicago, after having worked there for 5 years, I think?
Was six.
It? Six. So he did not get tenure. Why did he not get tenure? It is not because he's not a high-ranking scholar. Just have a quick look at his books and see how these books are being received in prominent international academic journals, like Foreign Affairs, like the London Review of Books, and last but not least, the Middle East Journal. So, why is it that he did not get tenure? To cut a very long story short, it is because of the contents of his books. These books raise the anger of the pro-Israel lobby, to put it crudely, in the United States and beyond the United States. And a campaign was being started under the supervision of Norman Finkelstein's nemesis, Alain Dershowitz, of Harvard University, and they succeeded. They succeeded him not getting tenure at the DePaul University. So here we are. He's unemployed, he's making tours, and tries to make a living. Just to mention two books which he did recently, well, not recently, 2003 and 2005. In 2003, he did The Holocaust Industry, which raised a lot of controversy all over the world. And in 2005, he published Beyond Chutzpah, which was a frontal attack on this person, Alain Dershowitz. This is what I would like to tell you as an introduction to Dr. Norman Finkelstein. I was a bit surprised when I talked to some students yesterday and the day before in the university. I asked them, "Are you coming to the lecture?" And they said, "The lecture by whom?" I said, "Finkelstein." And they said, "Whom?" This was very surprising, because I thought you were a celebrity in Holland. Well, maybe after this meeting you will get a bit more of a celebrity status. The word is used.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm not sure of my purpose in life is to acquire celebrity status. I do like faithful friends and comrades, and it is nice to be able to travel around the world and meet people who I've corresponded with and who have been there for me in difficult times. And this evening or this afternoon, I got to meet a person who I never met before, but he was at performing a crucial role. He was in charge of my website, while my usual website manager got married and went on a honeymoon. It was very unacceptable to me, but he did it anyway. So, Garrett Elbrink, now you... Are you a student here?
No, I'm just a student in Hilversum School of Arts. I've been studying right here.
He's a student in the Hilversum School of Arts.
I hope he doesn't give away any of the secrets of my website to the Mossad, but so far I trust him. So it's nice to be here.
Okay, then you have to use this. But you have to keep it in your hands.
I always have some reluctance about using this sort of microphone because I feel like Frank Sinatra. And I prefer to do it my way.
Gotcha. But it's your microphone not working?
No.
It's for the
opname.
It's okay. We'll manage. Okay. That having been said, I understand that this is a law faculty and your main interest is in law. I can't claim to be an authority in international law, but I have in recent years tried to master the relevant concepts and the relevant principles on the issue of the Israel-Palestine conflict. And let me just say a couple of words about why I proceed to try to learn the relevant principles and language. When I was a young man, the age of the students in this room, I was a person of the left, and the language of the left was more or less, it was a language of Marxism and socialism. And when you tried to reach people, try to reach a larger audience, that language could, on many occasions, work. But as Marxism and socialism began to lose currency in society, the language no longer worked. And so you have to find a language which expressed basic principles of justice, not perfect principles, but reasonable basic principles of justice, which a person of the left could use in order to reach a broader audience. And it rapidly became, or I rapidly came to the conclusion that the only language out there for a person on the left which could reach a broader audience was the language of international law and the language of human rights. And just on a personal note, it's quite remarkable the extent to which people who in the 1970s and into the 80s were on the Marxist and socialist left, you now find them populating the human rights organizations such as Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International. You would be quite surprised if you sat down for a moment and just traced back where many of these people were in the 1970s and 80s. They were on the conventional Marxist and socialist left, and now are in human rights organizations and trying to maintain their support for the same ideals, but now using a different kind of language. As I said, in many ways, this language, the language of international law and the language of human rights, is very imperfect. I've read through enough manuals on the laws of international humanitarian law to find them extremely dissatisfying. you can find in these manuals justifications under international humanitarian law for what I consider to be gross, in fact, horrendous violations of human rights. Sometimes I like to say that the very notion of laws of war is like the notion of etiquette for cannibals. There's just something wrong in the whole idea of trying to legalize an activity which is inherently and intrinsically barbaric. And in fact, I sometimes feel guilty because I know my late parents would find it extremely disappointing that I should be involved in an activity which somehow lends some sort of justification to war. That is to say, we can carry on war in a civilized or non-barbaric fashion. There's something just flat out wrong about that notion. There's something flat out wrong when the horrors that are inflicted on Gaza on a daily basis, the very best that human rights organizations can say, the maximum language that they can use, is that Israel is using disproportionate force. That just doesn't seem to rise to the moral occasion, as if to say, if the force were proportionate, it would be okay. I much prefer to listen and hear Jimmy Carter, the former president, who is no radical, but seems to have more moral understanding than most human rights organizations, when he says what Israel is doing in Gaza is an atrocity. That sounds to me like the right language, and not this dehuman language of disproportionate force. Having said all that, it happens that in the case of the Israel-Palestine conflict, the basic principles for resolving the conflict are remarkably uncomplicated. They raise no significant moral or legal questions. And so in the case of the principles for resolving the conflict, I feel perfectly at ease in supporting them and also in conveying them, because I don't think they raise any great moral issues. They are pretty much what you would call the common sense of the time. The fancy international law language, some of you in here, I suppose, know it, is to say these principles are peremptory norms of international law. Do you use that language here? I just want to be clear. How many people are in international law? Can you just raise your hand?
I'm afraid not too many.
Not too many.
The building belongs to the international law faculty, but right. The people in the audience are
a peremptory,
probably some different.
A peremptory norm basically just means an axiom or a basic principle which is not questioned or disputed any longer. It's a taken-for-granted principle. Now, we're often told that the Israel-Palestine conflict, in particular the resolution of it, is very complicated. And in fact, we're told it's uniquely complicated among conflicts in the world. But in fact, the people of Netherlands, more than anyone else, ought to know that it just ain't so. And to demonstrate it, we have a very compelling piece of evidence to use. There is this phenomenon, some of you may have heard of it, it's called the peace process. How many of you have heard of that? Okay. It's the longest running soap opera in the history of the world. And there is a subdivision of the peace process. It's called the final status issues. How many of you have heard of that? The final status issues. Okay, fewer in number. Lucky for you, the rest of you, you're too busy text messaging to be familiar with that. I think you're making the right choice. The final status issues are those issues which are alleged to be so complicated, so controversial, that they have to be put off to the last stage of negotiations, because we're told if you begin with them, the negotiations will immediately break down. So, as a test case of my assertion that this conflict is not complicated, we'll look at those final status questions, allegedly the most complicated of the whole conflict. And those questions are generally said to be four. Number one, the question of borders. What are the legitimate borders of the State of Israel, and what will be the legitimate borders of a Palestinian state? Number two, the question of settlements. What is the legal status of those 460,000 settlers and their settlements in the West Bank? Number three, the question of East Jerusalem. To whom, if to either side, does it belong? And number four, the question of the Palestinian refugees. Those are generally said to be the four final status, most controversial questions of the conflict. As I mentioned to you earlier, the people of Netherlands, yourselves, are in fact best placed to evaluate how controversial these questions are. Because in July 2004, the International Court of Justice, as it happens, ruled on three of the four of these questions. What happened was this. The General Assembly of the United Nations posed a question to the International Court. It asked the court to render what's called an advisory opinion. And the question they asked to the court was, can you tell us what is the legality of the wall that Israel is building in the West Bank? Now, in order to answer that question, the court had to answer some preliminary questions, questions that come before. For example, let us say that Israel has a legitimate claim on the West Bank. Then, the wall that Israel is building in the West Bank would not raise any legal questions, because obviously, any country is allowed to build a wall or a structure within its territorial borders. Or, as it happens, the wall that Israel is building is taking what the World Court called a sinuous, that means a winding, a sinuous route that goes around and incorporates the settlements. If the settlements are legal under international law, then obviously erecting a wall around the settlements would not raise any legal questions. Number three, it happens that the wall cuts right through East Jerusalem, separating out the Arab neighborhoods and incorporating the Jewish neighborhoods. If it's the case that Israel has a legal claim to East Jerusalem, then of course it has the right, by virtue of, if nothing else, eminent domain, to build a wall within East Jerusalem. So the court had to answer these questions: the legality, what are the borders, the legality of the settlements, to whom does East Jerusalem belong, before it could decide on the legality of the wall itself. Well, what did the International Court of Justice decide in its advisory opinion? Number one, on the question of borders, there is a fundamental principle, a peremptory norm of international law, and it goes something like this, that it's inadmissible, it's not allowed under international law to acquire territory by war. That's a basic principle. You see it in the second paragraph of the famous resolution 242, UN resolution 242. It states, emphasizing the inadmissibility of acquiring territory by war. In 1970, the United Nations General Assembly affirmed as a body that principle of the inadmissibility of acquiring territory by war. So the International Court of Justice said Israel acquired the West Bank and Gaza in the course of the June 1967 war. It has no title to those territories. They were acquired by war. And then the court went on to say that these territories have been designated as the unit for Palestinian self-determination, and therefore these territories constitute occupied Palestinian territories, capital O, capital P, capital T. If you look at human rights reports, they often refer to these territories as OPT, referring to the shorthand of the International Court of Justice. These are not, as you're sometimes told in public life, these are not disputed territories. There is no dispute whatsoever under international law as to the legitimate claim to those territories. They are occupied Palestinian territories, full stop. Number two, the question of those 460 or 80,000 settlers in these occupied Palestinian territories. What is their status? Under international law, the relevant body of law is the Fourth Geneva Convention, which addresses populations under occupation. It states that an occupying power cannot transfer its population to occupied territory. Those settlements, those settlers, says the International Court of Justice, they constitute and the court here quotes the United Nations Security Council resolution, those settlers and settlements constitute a flagrant violation of international law. Number three, the question of East Jerusalem. We're told that that's the most complicated question alongside the refugees. Indeed, Israel says East Jerusalem is part of its eternal and undivided capital. But not so, says the highest judicial body in the world. The World Court says, how did Israel acquire East Jerusalem? It acquired it in the course of the June 1967 war. It's inadmissible to acquire territory by war. East Jerusalem is, and the court is very explicit, East Jerusalem is occupied Palestinian territory. If you go through the court opinion, it refers to the West Bank, comma, including East Jerusalem, comma, and the Gaza Strip as occupied Palestinian territory to make sure there is no ambiguity or misunderstanding on the subject. That, in fact, is only part of the story, because the other part is how uncontroversial this particular opinion is. Often, in any judicial system, when a case reaches the uppermost level of the system, it's because the legal principles are controversial. And so there is a lot of contention. The lower court says this. The appeals court overturns the lower court. Then the higher level appeals court overturns the lower level appeals court. And then the uppermost level court is willing to entertain the case because it raises complicated legal issues. And that's also why, often at the highest level, the decision will be very close, because the issues themselves are legally complex. But that's not what happened here. What's remarkable is we are told these are the most complex issues of the Israel-Palestine conflict. Whereas in fact, the vote was 14-1. There was no controversy at all. The one dissenting vote, to which I'll return in a half moment, was Thomas Bergenthal, the American judge. But apart from him, there was no debate or discussion on these issues. In fact, there were some judges on the court who disagreed with this or that aspect of the majority opinion, including, if I'm not mistaken, the Dutch judge. Your judge in the court is Koymans. He issued a separate opinion where he expressed differences with the majority opinion on this or that aspect, but not, and I have to underline it, but not on the question of borders, Jerusalem, or settlements. There was no disagreement at all. In fact, the disagreement was so minimal that Thomas Bergenthal, the American judge, he had the option of issuing either a dissent, which means strong disagreement, or a declaration, which means minor disagreement. The one negative vote was not a dissent. It was merely a declaration which began with the words, quote, "There is much in the majority opinion with which I agree." And he ends his one negative vote by saying, "I have to agree on the question of the settlements. They are illegal. Article 49 is very clear. The settlements happen to be the core issue, because Israel obviously is not attempting to annex or appropriate the territory for its scenic value. It wants to exploit those territories. If the settlements are illegal, it's over." And on that crucial issue, the vote de facto was 15-0. I might add, for those of you who occasionally read these International Court of Justice opinions, they're often very big opinions. Interesting. I learn a lot from them. I'm going to start reading a large number of them on the Balkans War, and I actually am looking forward to it. They make for interesting reading. But this particular one on the wall, and the issues I just went through, settlements, borders, Jerusalem, it was less than 100 pages, because there's no interesting controversy about them. They are peremptory norms. They are the most ordinary conventional principles of international law. And the political translation of these legal principles, is expressed each year in the United Nations General Assembly, where it tries to fashion a settlement of the conflict. Everyone in this room can check for him or herself. All you have to do is Google "peaceful settlement of the Palestine question." And each year, the General Assembly, if the World Court is the highest judicial body in the world, the General Assembly is the highest, or at any rate, most representative political body in the world. And what the General Assembly does is it takes these legal principles, these uncontroversial legal principles, and then puts them forward as the political basis to settle the conflict. And everybody in this room knows that legal basis. It's called the two-state settlement of the Israel-Palestine conflict. The two-state settlement meaning a full Israeli withdrawal to the June 67 border in accordance with the principle inadmissibility of acquiring territory by war. Secondly, there's a fundamental principle of the United Nations Charter, Article 2. It's inadmissible to threaten any member nation with force. Threats or use of force are inadmissible in international law, and therefore neighboring Arab states, as well as a Palestinian state, have to recognize Israel's right to be free from threats or use of force. And the last principle for resolving the conflict is a resolution of the refugee question in accordance with UN Resolution 194, which calls for either repatriation or compensation for the refugees. Every year that resolution is voted on. Once again, what's most striking is there's no controversy. 1989, the vote, 151-3. The three dissenting countries, the United States, Israel, the island state of Dominica. 1996, the vote, 155-2. 1997, the vote, 154-2. This past year, 2007, the vote, 161-7. Now, some of you are thinking, aha, the number of negatives leaped from 2-7. And that's true. We don't want to exaggerate, misrepresent, falsify. We want to be accurate. And the seven are the same every year for the past 10 years. The seven are the United States, Israel, Nauru, N-A-U-R-U, Palau, P-A-L-A-U, Tuvalu, T-U-V-A-L-U, the Federated States of Micronesia, and the Marshall Islands. That's it. Some of you are laughing, either because you do, or on some occasions, don't know what those countries are. If it's any consolation, in a former life I was a professor who taught these subjects, and I had never heard of them. I subsequently was informed through massive email correspondence that they are South Sea Islands. Their combined populations could fill the empty seats in this room with some room left over. If you're very interested, Nauru's main export, I learned, is bird droppings. Tuvalu is disappearing due to global warming, and so forth. That's the record. The record is, and I'll close by quoting our former President of the United States, Jimmy Carter. He said in his last book, Palestine, Peace, Not Apartheid, he said, quote, "Peace will come to the Middle East and the Israel-Palestine conflict when Israel withdraws to its legal borders and recognizes international law." That is the problem. Don't allow anyone to fool you, mislead you, divert your attention by claiming there are cultural problems, civilizational conflicts, religious enmities, biblical hatreds. These are all phrases designed to divert your attention from a remarkably uncontroversial, straightforward, simple record. Israel, crucially backed by the United States, refuses to accept implementing the basic principles of international law. Thank you.
Could you say a few words? A few words on the U.S.'s position. Do you think that the next president, either Obama or McCain, will they make a difference? And if so, in what respect? And secondly, in this regard, in one of the interviews you gave when you visited Holland last time, I think, you refer to the strength of the Israel lobby in the U.S. And then you said that it has been weakened recently. which was a very interesting remark. And in that context, you also referred to Jimmy Carter and his latest book. So could you please say a few words on both points? Thank you.
I think that it's easy for people to be misled by opinion at the very top of any society where power is concentrated, and to confuse it with popular public opinion. It is a curiosity that on the Israel-Palestine conflict, at the uppermost tier of most of the societies in Europe now, the governments are more pro-Israel than ever. Berlusconi, Sarkozy, and so forth. Merkel, God forbid, Merkel being probably the worst, but they're all pretty terrible. Nonetheless, it is very clear that the level of popular public opinion, Israel is losing ground rapidly. I was very struck yesterday. I spoke at a church with the former Prime Minister of the Netherlands, who I didn't speak to ahead of time. We just met at that moment. What's his name?
Banach.
And he himself said, he wasn't cued by me, he said on his own, public opinion is rapidly changing. It's very clear in the case, for example, of Germany, where the poll was taken 2 weeks ago. Merkel talks about the special commitment of Germans to Israel, special responsibility. The German people were asked, do you have a special responsibility? 60% said no. Should Germany be selling arms to Israel? 84% said no. All the polls that are taken in Europe, the BBC polls, the EU polls, what's the main threat to world peace? Israel, 59%. Of 12 countries, which has the best and the worst image? 2007, worst image of 12 countries in the world, Europeans rate Israel. 2008, they got 3 points ahead of Iran, you know, which is not great shakes, if that's the best you can do. 3 points ahead of Iran. Just yesterday, somebody mailed me a poll of 140 countries in the world which has the worst record on peace. Israel ranked 136. The only ones below it were Chad, Iraq, and somebody else. Among popular opinion, Israel is rapidly losing ground, and you see it in the United States as well. I would say don't focus on the top yet. That's always the most difficult nut to crack. But we shouldn't be hopeless about it. It was the same, speaking for my generation during the war in Vietnam. The last people to change were the political elites and the major media. And they only changed in 1968 after the Tet Offensive, where it was clear the war was lost. Popular opinion was way ahead of elite opinion and the political classes. So there's no question Barack Obama, McCain, Ms. Clinton are horrible on this particular question, but I don't think that should make us hopeless. Because, as the former Prime Minister said, we're still a democratic society, and we still can impose our will if we learn to organize, mobilize, and show the discipline and show the sacrifice that's required.
But isn't there a difference between Obama and McCain? There is, isn't it?
It's very hard to say how different it will be. Some people say, people whose opinions I respect, it might actually be worse under Obama, because the one thing preventing the U.S. from wreaking murder and mayhem on the world at this point is everybody hates Bush.
and that's acting as a impediment, a check on American power. And the moment Barack Obama is elected, there's going to be a lot of popular support for him around the world, because people around the world, for reasons which will never make sense to me, love to worship the United States, including people in this room, and they'll look for the opportunity again to be able to worship at the American altar. And Barack will give that opportunity. He has a very nice smile.
We had an interview just earlier, and one of our discussions was about, you know, the changing perspective vis-a-vis Muslims in the West, in Europe, after 9/11, and the impact of Muslims in Europe in particular. And I think what you also said was that, apart from the political economic analysis of the support for Israel and the key role of Israel in the Middle East, there's another instrument, which is the ideological support and sentiments towards Israel that maintains their hegemony. How do we understand this dynamics of, you know, the ideological or cultural instrument or card played vis-a-vis different resistance movements in the Middle East? In other words, can we understand the essentialist, stereotypical, problematic stance towards Hezbollah and Hamas, also as a partly Islamophobe attitude, and is that the reason why resistance of these movements are not respected or valued? And in that sense, what is your opinion about movements like resistance movements like Hezbollah and Hamas, because it's very controversial to support them? Where do you stand in this discussion?
I'll speak not with great knowledge, but a minimum understanding, having looked through the record, on the question of the Hezbollah. The Hezbollah's record, for an audience like this, the Hezbollah's record on human rights happens to be very excellent, as compared to other countries in the world. Now, for some of you, that may be a very difficult pill to swallow, and I'm not interested in trying to win popularity contests. I'm simply interested in looking at what the record shows. If you go through the record since the 1990s, Hezbollah has never targeted civilians except when Israel first initiated attacks on civilians. When Israel occupied the zone in the south, Hezbollah only targeted Israeli combatants, which is legal under international law, obviously, except when Israel, in moments of desperation, when it saw it was losing the guerrilla war to the Hezbollah, it started to target civilians. And then Hezbollah, in retaliation, launched strikes against civilians in northern Israel. Now, under international law, and I've taken the time to investigate it, the technical term is those are belligerent reprisals, which basically means if you target our civilians, we're going to target yours until you stop. And when you stop, we'll stop. I'm very happy to discuss it with you. I'm very happy to. If you look, for example, at the standard manuals, like the International Commission of the Red Cross's Standard Manual on Humanitarian Law, it will state that it is true that a large number of countries in the world have come out against belligerent reprisals. That is, under no circumstances is it legal to target civilians. But the manual says it is not true that it is yet a rule of international law. So Hezbollah's use of belligerent reprisals when Israel targets civilians is legal under international law. Let's look at another aspect of, listen, I am very happy to hear you out. I'm in no rush to leave. I'm serious, but you have to let me finish. Now, let's look at two other aspects of the Hezbollah record. July 2006, it's engaged in a war with Israel. What does the record show? At the end of the war, Israel killed 1,200 Lebanese, of whom 80%, 1,000, were civilians. Hezbollah killed 160 Israelis, of whom 25%, 43, were civilians. Whether you look at the numbers absolutely, 1,000 versus 43, or relatively, 80% civilians versus 25% civilians, the record of Hezbollah is much better. On the question of use of cluster bomblets, Human Rights Watch stated that Hezbollah used 3,000 cluster bomblets against Israel. But Israel used, according to Human Rights Watch, between 3.5 and 4.6 million cluster bomblets against Lebanon. Whose record is worse? Let's not use Israel's record. Let's take the European record. Look at the record on treatment of collaborators at the end of a conflict. At the end of World War II, the numbers run from tens to hundreds of thousands of collaborators who were killed and lynched in France at the war's end. At the end of the war, at the end of the Israeli occupation of Lebanon, there were many collaborators, the South Lebanon Army. Hezbollah gave out an order, not one. You turn it off.
Je moet even deze microfoon op de tafeltje zetten.
Not one collaborator was killed. Personally, I was kind of shocked. I was in Lebanon a few months ago, and I went on a tour of the South with the Hezbollah, and they took me to the Qiyam prison, the famous torture center that Israel set up in South Lebanon. And the person who was taking me on the tour, he had been held and tortured for 12 years in that prison. In fact, they took his brother as a hostage to try to break him. His brother was held for 5 years. And I asked him after he showed me around the whole prison, with a couple of exceptions, a couple of cubicles have been destroyed by Israel in the last war. They don't want to have any memories of the torture chambers, so they blew them all up during the 2005-2006 war. I said to him at the end, just out of curiosity, I said to him, well, do you ever see the guys who tortured you? He said, yeah. As a matter of fact, I see him every day in the street. I said, you see him every day in the street? He said, yeah. And you know what? Israel gave him tens of thousands of dollars for what he did. And the Lebanese government gave me, for my 12 years in jail, They gave me $100. And I said to him, you don't want to kill the guy? And you know what his answer was? Hezbollah said, no retaliation, no retaliation. That's a very impressive record. I'd like you to show me another case of an occupation where there was no retaliation whatsoever against their collaborators. Those are the facts. It has nothing to do with being pro-Hezbollah, pro their politics. It has to do with elementary principles, but applying them across the board. Let's see Israel's record. Let's see the Hezbollah's record. Let's see France's record. Let's see the Hezbollah's record. Is it perfect? Of course not. But is it worse than other countries? Or in fact, amazingly, is it maybe even better? And the facts show it's better.
Thank you.
Now, I know you feel frustrated, so I'm going to ask, we break the protocol and let you speak.
Yeah. Nou, beter dat u niet krijgt.
I can't hear you. If you don't mind, can you stand up so you can project? Thank you. Okay, let me try to go through those points one by one. On the question of what the court decided in its advisory opinion, as a matter of fact, it did not state it was a fait accompli. It says it appears that it might be a fait accompli, but that wasn't the grounds on which it ruled the war was illegal. It looked at the principles of the Hague regulations and the Geneva Convention on what you're allowed to do in terms of military self-defense. And they said that the damages that were being wrought by the wall could not possibly be justified by the claims of protection that Israel said it needed from the wall. It did what's called a balancing act and said you couldn't justify it. I said what I was referring to was the court's opinion on the principles for resolving the conflict. And the principles are settlements are illegal, acquisition of territory by war is illegal, East Jerusalem is Palestinian territory. That is the principles. And I didn't notice anywhere where the court said those principles can be violated in the course of negotiating a settlement. Were that the case, what's the point of the principles? if they simply can be discarded or ignored when you carry on the process of resolving the conflict. You must surely know that Israel is at least consistent enough to deny the principle. They say it's not true that you're not allowed to acquire territory by war. Or they say that you're only not allowed to acquire territory in an aggressive war, but you're allowed to acquire territory in a defensive war. But never have I heard what you're alleging, that the principle is valid as a principle, but irrelevant in the negotiations to end the conflict. Then what's the point of elaborating a principle? It becomes an empty abstraction. What was the third question? The third was on Germany, the middle question.
Well, the first point I would make was that court only rules about legality of the court.
On the legality, and I said this is...
Disputed territories.
No, these are not disputed territories. You may want them to be disputed territories. You may wish they are. They are not disputed. Did the court refer to them as disputed territories, or did it refer to them as, quote, occupied Palestinian territories? Where did that language come from? Did I invent it? Open up Human Rights Watch. It refers to occupied Palestinian territories. Where did that language come from? Amnesty International refers to occupied... No, it's not. You see, that's, with all due respect, that's the rule of gangsters. It will be what we decide. That's not the rule of law. The rule of law says it's inadmissible to acquire territory by war. At least be
political decisions.
Can I okay. I want to answer. No. I have to say, you're not serious, because your original objection was when I referred to Hezbollah and belligerent reprisals.
Yes.
And when I proceed to say, just open up the ICRC manual, you immediately cast that aside and you invent something else. That's not serious. No. I want to just answer the last point on the question of German responsibility. My opinion is that one of the lessons of the Nazi era ought to be that none of us, any of us, has any responsibility to a state. We have responsibility to principles of justice, and we have responsibility to principles of truth. But surely, one of the lessons of that era of blind state worship ought to be not to claim a special responsibility to a state. That was a big problem back then. We have responsibility to principles of justice and truth, full stop.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, I'm going to explain in Dutch and then okay. Okay, de spelregels zijn als volgt. De zaal krijgt nu het woord. We verzamelen 2-3 vragen. Alvorens deze aan Norman Finkelstein mee te geven, zodat we in ieder geval een aantal compartimenten hebben van Q&A tijdens de discussie. Ik wil even vragen aan verzoeken, juist ook naar aanleiding van de reacties van de mevrouw achterin, of iedereen in ieder geval kort en bondig wil zijn in zijn reactie of haar reactie, maar ook respect willen hebben voor de antwoorden van de spreker en voor de antwoorden en vragen van de mensen in de zaal. Mevrouw, u heeft heel veel tijd gekregen, meer dan wie dan ook vandaag zal krijgen. U heeft 10 minuten de tijd gekregen, het getuigt van een beetje beschaafdheid om ook te luisteren naar wat anderen zeggen en wat de spreker zegt. Als u dat niet wil, mag u gaan, maar wij willen in ieder geval verder gaan met een gezonde discussie.
Mag ik nog één ding eraan toevoegen? I was still in English. As Miriam already said, I work on this Zemzem journal. It just came out last week. It's a Nakba special. And one of the authors is Ston van Hauke, who is making pictures all the time, very irritatingly. But Ston and I are the jury. The three best questions, those people will get a free copy of this themselves. So,
wow.
Please.
Okay, stick your hands up and Paul, help you.
Yeah, sure.
So Paul and I will try to trace, oh wait, there's so many hands already. As we said, 2-3 questions at a time and we'll come back to the speaker. Shafi.
You said territory you
acquire. Can you stand up when speaking?
Yeah. I have a sore throat. So I can't speak very loud. But you said territory you acquire by war is illegal.
Yes.
So what about 48 and a territory what's acquired in 48? What about that?
Good question. Okay, this question.
I would like to, thank you first, but secondly, I would like to know your opinion on the subject of the one-state solution, because I've heard you a little bit about the two-state solution, and I was very impressed, but and I think that all these principles of law could very well be included in a one-state solution. What's your opinion on that?
Okay, thank you. And it would be nice if you stand up and maybe introduce yourself, Chef. And then, as the last one for this round, is the two men in the back, and then we'll ask Norma to respond.
Yeah, I would like to thank you for showing how the Israeli-Palestine conflict could be solved through ordinary common sense solution. But some time ago, in the 18th century, an American revolutionary called Tom Paine made a distinction between common sense and nonsense. And I think that international law represents the common sense, but not necessarily the good sense. So when we look at the conflict, necessarily good sense means to me what is in the good for both Palestinians and the Israelis, and just what might be the friction between the common sense and the good sense. Because to me, there is a principal problem with the state of Israel as a Zionist state. Its fundamental form is against all these common sense forms, so that at a certain point you cannot solve it as a common sense way. The Israeli state needs to stop being a Zionist state, aka the state of Israel needs to be dismantled.
Okay, last speaker is the one in the back. I would ask everybody, please remember your question and remind me. Who wants to ask a question after the answer?
My question goes to, and the question is, I'd like you to please define the word terrorism as it was 300 years back, and that of which we have recently created by the United Nations and so-called the international law, so that we can figure which sort of act and who is against that word, and who are acting upon that word. And secondly, I want to quote from what I read from the news. There is no peace in the Holy Land because West doesn't respect East and Muslim law. I quote. Israeli, Yamav Israel, most famous Orthodox rabbi said, and I quote, Israel's most famous Orthodox rabbi believes that the disrespect of the Muslim world by Westerners and Jews is the root cause of stalled peace between Israelis and the Palestinians. I want you to, from the vent to give us, I want you to analyze this, whether is it right or wrong. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Do you remember?
I'm going to try, but I'm a little bit tired. I generally have a good memory, but It's being tested the last few days. I don't know quite what country or what planet I'm on most of the time. Just give me three words what you asked and everything will come back to me.
48.
Okay, 48. There is an issue under the UN partition plan. Israel was awarded 56% of Palestine, Palestinians 44%. As everybody knows, by the end of the war, they acquired in the course of the war another 20% of Palestine, so they had 80% at the end of the war. And people often raise the question, well, what about that acquisition of territory by war? Shouldn't that also be illegal? So why do you focus on the June 67 border and not on the partition resolution border? Those are all reasonable questions. And I think the only answer I can give, which I honestly believe, is that if you sit down, take the trouble, go through the deliberations of the United Nations after the June 67 war, there was what was called a meeting of the fifth emergency special session of the General Assembly, and then it was carried over to the Security Council at the end of the year. Most nations in the world, they were actively involved in trying to find a solution to the conflict. There was a Latin American bloc, there was an Afro-Asian bloc, there was a Soviet bloc, a European bloc. When you read it, I see a good faith effort. I think people tried very hard to find principles to try to end this conflict and achieve a peace. And the assumption seemed to be it was impractical to try to roll things back to the partition border. I think there's an argument to be made there. I didn't see malevolence, I didn't see evil. What I saw was people trying very hard to figure out, as a political body committed to peace ought to do, let's try to figure out a reasonable settlement. And under the circumstances, that seemed to be the best formula they can come up with, though yes, you could see that there were some violations of principles there, which is one of the ironies, because Israel often makes the claim that the United Nations is biased against it. But on the fundamental issue of inadmissibility of acquiring territory by war, the one exception you can find from 48 on, they let Israel acquire territory by war. It's the one exception.
One state.
As an old-time leftist, I see not the slightest reason why you should support one state as against no states. It used to be a principle of the left that we were out to, as they used to call it, destroy the state and create a communist beautiful tomorrow and so on and so forth. So it's strange now all of a sudden people on the left, or they think they're on the left, are now advocating one state as against no state. My opinion, if you read all of the international law rulings, human rights reports, and so forth, they're all premised on one fundamental notion. And the fundamental notion is the West Bank and Gaza, including East Jerusalem, those are occupied territories. There is no assumption, no inference, that Israel is occupied territory. Israel is a member state of the United Nations like any other member state of the United Nations. The moment you try to upset those assumptions that this is an issue of occupation, that Israel is a member state of the United Nations like any other state, the moment you try to upset those assumptions and try to create a new framework, your battle is a real uphill battle. You now have to change the whole of world opinion, which has crystallized around the two-state settlement. Now, it's fine for you here to speculate on things like a one-state settlement, but is it really morally right to be telling the Palestinian people that probably it'll take about four or five generations
to turn world opinion around, and until then, they will have to endure and be tormented by this occupation. I don't think that's a morally tenable position. It's a nice position if you sit around in a cafe or a salon, but I think it's morally unacceptable.
Can I intervene here? No. Because I think there are quite a few Palestinians discussing this in Palestine and in London and in Amsterdam among themselves. So
I'm not sure if quite a few is as many as some people make it out to be. And it still doesn't change the fact, you know, a fundamental principle of politics, in my opinion, is politics is not a menu or a smorgasbord where you choose the selection that most appeals to you. Politics is about dealing within what's historically feasible and what's historically possible. And every other movement that I'm familiar with, which has succeeded, has stuck by its goal. 1912, 1914, the South Africans say we want one person, one vote. They didn't change mid-course. The Vietnamese, they want the Americans out. They don't change mid-course. And all of this changing of mid-course is fundamentally, in my opinion, an expression of boredom. The two-state settlement is now boring. In English, in American English, they say it's no longer sexy. They want something more interesting. But that, to me, if you'll excuse my saying so, it's a very immature politics. It has nothing to do. You focus on that goal, and you try to win it. But you don't just change every few years because you're bored with what you're currently doing.
Zionism is a character of the state of Israel.
With all due respect, I think that's a slogan. Zionism has to be dismantled. I think in general, states have to be dismantled. And I'm not going to focus on the Israeli state, because that becomes a kind of monomania and obsession. Young man back here, Yeli Brunsma, he mentioned to me this morning that Human Rights Watch issued a report just this past week on all the discriminatory structures in the Netherlands state and the ways it discriminates against Muslims and Arabs. So my view is, before you talk about dismantling the Zionist state, show a little humility and talk about dismantling your own state. And then we can move on to the Israeli state.
He's doing that. He's doing that every day. Okay. And the last question was
Samantha. That's fair, that's consistent. Okay.
First on terrorism definition.
On the question of terrorism, my own view is, in principle, it's not the worst definition that it's illegal to target civilians to achieve a political goal. I don't have a problem with the definition, the principle. I have the problem with the application. Namely, it's used against one party to a conflict and not another party to the conflict. Let's take the case now of the sanctions, the brutal sanctions, which are being directed against the people of Gaza. Everybody knows the purpose of those sanctions is to get the Palestinians to reject Hamas as their leadership, to repudiate them. So the Palestinians are basically told that until you repudiate Hamas, these sanctions will continue. When you throw them out of office, we will lift the sanctions. Well, that's targeting a civilian population for a political goal. That's terrorism. And my problem is it's not referred to as terrorism, not the principle itself, but the hypocritical application of it. our job is, in my view, not to reject the principle, which is not the worst, but to make sure it's being applied in a consistent pattern, in a consistent fashion, to all the parties to the conflict.
And then this strange quote of the rabbi. You want him to answer that?
The one for the rabbi.
The east-west.
There's no peace in the Holy Land because West doesn't respect east and east more. What is your opinion for that?
It depends on how you see the fundamentals of the conflict. If Iraq, Iran, Saudi Arabia, if they were Buddhist, my guess is the conflict wouldn't be very much different. They would invent some reasons why we should hate Buddhist fundamentalists. It's not about Buddhism, it's not about Islam, it's about strategic resources, strategic areas. I don't really think it has much to do with these sorts of things. Ideologies are very, very flexible. And you can mobilize populations, unfortunately, with relative ease to oppose any religion or ideology which happens to get in the way of power. Has very little to do, I think, with the intrinsic nature of Muslim or Islamic culture or religion. I don't believe it has much to do with that.
All right, the second round of questions. I forgot exactly who, but I saw you and you, Muhammad, and then the lady on the right.
Yes,
stand up and be speak a bit loud.
Yeah, I have a list of comments. I understand what you were trying to say about the language shift from on the left, and that we could no longer use the language because it doesn't make sense anymore. So it goes to human rights. But there's a language shift in the Middle East as well, which is shifting more towards resistance, and doesn't fit, human rights doesn't fit in. In fact, we don't have a stake in this international, other than the governments are a different story. So what we see here is a split similar to what you said about Barack Obama and the people are actually siding more with the resistance movements. And we should not take Abu Mazen and Mubarak and his life to be representing the population. The last vote in Palestine is very clear about the Palestinians. If you say we are a few, but I would say the last vote is very clear about what the Palestinians have voted on. And the boredom is actually the two-state solution. If we want to say that people got bored, so they went into something new, is that they got bored and they decided to go along with the two-state solution. It was never a two-state solution. Historically, it was never the case. And we always had, I mean, Palestine, you're talking about the mother of all causes in the Arab world, and I don't think that this is a misrepresentation when I say so. We have the strategy of Sumud, and the strategy of Sumud means if we can't solve it now, we'll wait, and the next generation will solve it, but we will not take what peanuts or what our rights are. I find it very problematical that we say dismantle your state first and then talk about the Palestinians. Have we said that about South Africa? Yes, the apartheid state in South Africa had to be dismantled first before other states. I think the complications, as you said, it's very uncomplicated issues in the final status are very uncomplicated. There's an even easier solution, I would say. If Israel tomorrow would come and say, let's have a one state, and the refugees are to come back, I think that would be solved overnight instead of going through the 4, 6, 10, 11, I don't know, whatever points we have. It's very easy, it's less complicated, and it's on one point when you look at the two-state solution, or the one-state solution. Once we move from a one-state solution to these uncomplicated complications, we're really not settling back, or let's say falling back on fundamentals. We're actually jumping back on pragmatism, which is politics, and this is not values, it's politics at the end.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next question.
Thank you, my name is Sahiti from a different Jewish voice. I would like to know, you spoke about the responsibility of the State of Israel to deal with refugees, to give them repatriation or compensation. What is the responsibility of the neighboring countries to deal with the Palestinian refugees in the meantime?
Okay, good. The lady in the back, yes, you? Louder, please.
I.
Well, you see, that's right.
Is it not also the case that because Israel has no state, that their record of human rights is sort of exaggerated in reference to other states using violence? And then the second question has to do with the spiritual legitimation of Israel regarding occupied territories and the social legitimation of that. And I was wondering how you feel that the change in perceptions on Israel.
Okay, last question, very brief. I saw, yeah, Kurt?
Hello, my name is Leo. I had a question about, it's about the, we talk a lot about the international law and how most countries accept the international law besides, well, just focus on two. But what I'm missing a bit is why these two don't accept it. So if you could elaborate a bit more on why Israel and the United States don't want to withdraw to the foreign border.
All right, I'm going to ask Romer to answer, and then I'll come back one more time for two or three questions, very brief.
On the first question, there's a factual matter, there's a moral matter, and then there's a political matter. Let's start with the factual matter. In November 1988, the Palestinian National Council met, and in a very representative meeting, they voted for the two-state settlement. It was clear that the Palestinians at that point saw it as a compromise, a historical compromise. But under the circumstances, I said politics is about what's historically possible, feasible, and realistic. The vote was for the two-state settlement. There is no evidence whatsoever, the evidence is precisely zero, that if given that option of a two-state settlement on the June 1967 border with a just resolution of the refugee question, there's no question whatsoever, as of now, opinion may change, the Palestinians, if in a national referendum, would accept that settlement. Your claims that they've already rejected it or never accepted it, so far as I can tell, have no basis in reality. It's easy enough for you here to talk about steadfastness. It's a little bit more difficult if you're living in the West Bank in Gaza. And I think we all have to be very morally cautious about telling people there that they should live for several more generations under those conditions with no hope whatsoever that they will improve. I, for one, being here and not there, would not be so presumptuous as to tell them that they have to endure those conditions for several more generations. You say public opinion has shifted, but of course the record shows precisely the contrary. That's why in 2006, in the prisoners' agreement, Hamas and Fatah both came out supporting the two-state settlement on the June 67 border with a national referendum to approve it. So if anything, Hamas's position today is closer to that of the international consensus. What you're saying, to judge by the record and not by rhetoric, is factually inaccurate. On the question of responsibility for the refugees, my own view is neighboring countries have no responsibility because they did not create the problem. The responsibility bears on those who created it. Should they have shown
more generosity? The answer, in my opinion, is of course yes. But philanthropy and charity and generosity are different moral values than a kind of legal value of culpability and responsibility. The culpability and the responsibility bear on Israel. Charity, generosity, philanthropy, they bear on the neighboring Arab states, and the record on the matters of generosity, philanthropy, and generosity have been terrible. If you're a Lebanese and decent Lebanese secular nationalist, have called for giving the Lebanese Palestinian citizenship. And I think that's right. But you can't say it's a responsibility. They did not create the problem. If you see a homeless person in the street, it's generous, it's philanthropic, it's charitable to give the person a shelter in your house. But I've never heard it said it's your responsibility to take that person in. I don't do it. I'll be honest. I have space in my apartment. Certainly, I can put down a mat. But I can't say it's my responsibility. As a human being, it certainly would demonstrate generosity from my part if I did. But I don't. And the same principle, it seems to me, applies with the case of the refugees. Responsibility incurs on those who created the problem. The
Hezbollah, human rights.
Well, there were two questions. The first one was on Hezbollah, and is it held to a separate, different standard because it's not a state and it's a resistance movement, or sometimes they use the stupid expression sub-state actor. You can use the ordinary standards for them, and they still come out okay. Now, you might want to argue that they would even come out more okay if they were a state and not just a sub-state actor, which is, you know, possibly true because states have the monopoly on the use of force, and they can get around with killing people, and that's called civilization. But even if you use the ordinary standards with them, the record is not bad. So I have no problem with using that record, you know, that standard with them.
Perception of the people regarding
Palestine. You know, the reason, and I'm going to here speak in a slightly less academic fashion, the reason people hate Hezbollah in the West is because they happen to be smart, they're very efficient, they're serious, they're focused. The West likes stupid Arabs. You know, they think King Hussein was, you know, a great model of an Arab leader. That's their notion. You know, you read books by mainstream people, the one that just came out by Aaron David Miller on the peace process, and he says the last great Arab leader was, you know, King Hussein. You know, that's their notion. A complete idiot, you know, a plaything of the West. They like to call him the plucky little king. You know, that's their idea. Anyone who they have contempt for, this fellow is very serious. Very intelligent, very focused. They don't like that. They're very nervous about that. That's the reason they don't like him. Not because of the fundamentalism. Oh, the king of Saudi Arabia is less fundamentalist? You know, that's not serious. The reason is because he's a very smart guy and he's not a blowhard.
Okay, last one, right?
Nee,
yeah.
Dat kan echt niet. You
was.
I was a question.
Why international law is neglected by U.S. and Israel?
The reason is not really... The reason is both simple and complicated. The simple answer is that when you have power, you disregard the law. That's the way most people carry on. And that's the way the U.S. and Israel carry on, that we'll do what we want. Basically, what the woman who's left us said before, that she doesn't care about the principles. And that's how people with power usually carry on. Why the U.S. and Israel do it? In the case of the United States, in my opinion,
It's the lobby, because the U.S. has no real stake in the occupation. You ask yourself in a moment's reflection, what does the U.S. stand to gain from the settlements? What does it stand to gain from the colonization of the occupied territories? What does it stand to gain from the wall? The answer is pretty obviously nothing. And if Israel were tomorrow to say, we're packing up and we're leaving, and we're going back to the June 67 border, it's very hard to imagine that any American political leader will say, no, terrible, you have to stay. Well, since no American leader would oppose it, the reasonable inference is it serves no U.S. interest. And if it serves no U.S. interest, then it's probably the lobby that is getting its way on this particular issue. In the case of Israel, you might want to ask the question, why do they not want to leave? And there are a lot of reasons put forth. There are usually two kinds of reasons. There is the ideological claim that these are Zionists and, you know, West Bank and Gaza or Judea, Samaria, the Jewish homeland. That's the ideological reason, the Zionism explanation. And then there is the materialistic explanation, so forth. They're there for the water and the land resources. They want to expropriate the valuable water and the best land there. I personally think it's neither of those explanations. I think it's mostly a kind of political explanation that Israel, once it's got a piece of territory, it just won't leave, because in their mind it shows weakness. And whenever you've conquered something, you keep it, and you have to tell the Arabs you're not going to get it, because it's ours. It's the same thing in South Lebanon. At the beginning, when Israel occupied South Lebanon in 78 and onwards, you know, people said it was for the water and the Litani. And they had all sorts of materialistic explanations, that they wanted to carve out a Christian state, the water and the Litani, and so forth. But by 2000, it was clear it was not water in the Litani. Why did they stay? Simple reason. Hezbollah wanted them to leave. And they did not want to show weakness to that guerrilla army. It wasn't the territory itself. It was transmitting the message to the Arab world, what we say goes. And if you try to force our hand, we will break your skull. The Israelis always like to say Arabs only understand the language of force. And in fact, it's Israelis who only understand the language of force. And so I don't think the ideological or the material explanation is really adequate. I think it's a political explanation that Israel never leaves until it's forced out. That's just the nature of that regime.
Thank you. Okay, we'll come to the last round of questions. We only have time for two questions because, I mean, we've already...
Okay. You said in 1968, the Tet Offensive, and then we realized the United States should lose the war. Do you have a sign in Israel that they lose the war?
Okay.
My name is Solomon Yoder. One sentence. Was the unilateral declaration of independence by Israel contrary to international law?
There's room for one question left. I saw hands. No? Yep?
Well, you know.
Stand up, please.
You said that that Israel only learns the language of, understands the language of force, but you're advocating a legal solution. So isn't there a mismatch?
No.
Okay, good question.
No, it's a good question, but probably because I didn't convey my opinion clearly enough. It's a fair question, but I don't think it's a contradiction. And maybe I'll take those two questions together because the answer is the same basically to both. I never said the two-state settlement is going to happen tomorrow. And I recognize it's a struggle. But there's a basic principle of politics. I used to be in my younger years this phenomenon called a Maoist, the follower of Chairman Mao. Most of you in this room don't even know who or what that is. It sounds like a detergent. But Chairman Mao, the leader of, at that time, a communist China, he used to say a basic principle of politics is unite the many to defeat the few. There is an international consensus for resolving the conflict. The challenge now is to take that moral will and turn it into a political force. That's uniting the many to defeat the few. And I think politically that's much more possible than uniting the few to defeat the many. To now try to change all of international public opinion to this notion of one state. That's politics. Politics is not about choosing whatever solution you like, but looking at what public opinion is saying and trying to mobilize it, so long, of course, as it's in a positive direction. Force takes many forms. I said force, I didn't say violence. There are different ways to impose force. Sanctions are force. Public opinion is force. People don't like sitting in the room and hearing if they're supporters of Israel. They don't like to hear Israel is constantly violating international law. They feel uncomfortable with it. You keep reminding them of that fact, some of them will start to change because it's an embarrassment. That's what the cultural boycott of apartheid was all about. Embarrassing these people, because cultural boycott, it's not actually hurting your pocket. It's turning you into a moral pariah in the world. And that's why white people in South Africa didn't like being moral pariahs. They want to be part of the world community. That's also force. Force can take many different forms. And I think mobilizing public opinion and showing this is the obstacle. These two countries, they are what's blocking it. That is quite a quite formidable force, because Israel does everything in its power to prove it ain't so. They say it's about a clash of civilizations, it's about fundamentalism, it's about biblical enmities. They do everything to change the subject, which is one reason they're coming to loathe Jimmy Carter. Because he's saying, no, it's very simple. I talk to the Arab leaders. They want to negotiate. I talk to Hamas. They want to negotiate. Everyone accepts that 67 border except you. You're the problem. They don't like that. They don't like the world seeing it's the many against the few. And I think that's how to proceed. Jimmy Carter's politics are not my politics, but he's a political person, and he wants to resolve the conflict. And he knows what politics is about. And he's isolating Israel and saying, you're the problem, because he knows that's the way to undo them. I think that's how politics should be. The question you asked about the refugees. I'm not going to be a hypocrite on that question. I think you're right. Hamas said it has to be a national referendum of all the Palestinians.
including the refugees. I think that's correct. I cannot dispute that is fair and that's reasonable. I am not convinced, however, that if you propose a reasonable settlement, you won't get the vote. I haven't seen the evidence of that yet. Maybe I'm wrong. I have to see. First of all, we're not there yet, because the world has not yet, or at any rate, the United States and Israel, have not proposed a reasonable settlement. I have Palestinian refugees who are my closest friends. As a matter of fact, I'm flying to one tonight in Fawar camp. And I asked him, he said to me, Norman, I am a conservative on the refugee question. I'm not ready to give up that right. So I said to him, okay, then what do you support? And he said, propose something to us. Let me see the proposal. Let me see what you're offering, and then we'll decide. My view is Palestinians are perfectly reasonable. Make a reasonable settlement, and then let's see what happens. But I don't see why we should close off that possibility and tell this man and tell his children and tell his newly born grandchild and then the grandchild after that and grandchild after that, no, forget it, we're waiting for one state and your children will have to live like you, who have to live like your father. I'm not doing that. I don't live there. And I don't think it's morally responsible to make that kind of proposal here. I do not. I don't know where you just dreamt that up from. Was there anything I said which in any way suggested Palestinians don't have an understanding? Is there any word I said that in any way implied that?
Yes.
What I said was make a reasonable settlement offer to them and let's see what they say. I don't know what it is. All
okay.
I know is nothing has yet even approached it from the U.S. and Israel, because they don't even accept those basic principles of international law. They don't accept the inadmissibility of acquiring territory by war. They don't accept that East Jerusalem belongs to the Palestinians. They don't accept that all the settlements are illegal, and they don't accept the right of return. So if they don't even accept those principles, we're nowhere near that. I acknowledge that.
Okay. All right. Please, it's 5 o'clock. Please, there are two questions. Okay, very brief.
He did make an example that when he meets a refugee or somebody on the street, he will be generous to pick that person to his home.
Yeah.
And you would take the responsibility. In that case, if that person realized, I will tell you that, okay, tomorrow, I found in a book 300 years ago that that house belongs to you, it's my land, you have to evacuate. Such is what is happening today. Israel have been trashed out from Western or from the European countries. They have been wiped out altogether, and the Palestine have welcomed them. And today, they are saying that they found in their Talmud or their Torah that that land belongs to them. How can you reconcile that statement and your statement?
You're trying to break through a door that's already open. I am not supporting that.
Okay, he's trying to answer your question. Let him.
I agree with you that you couldn't possibly use a biblical claim for them. Of course, I think that's obviously true.
Okay. All right, we have...
I think there were two last questions. The first of the two last questions was basically the question is there any evidence yet of a turning point like the Tet Offensive in 1968 where ruling elites decide this war is hopeless, we have to leave? No, there isn't yet evidence of a turning point because I don't think Israel is yet convinced that it can't win using force. It's no doubt, it's inevitable, regrettably, that it's going to attack Lebanon again because their view is, okay, we're down, but we're not out. We want another crack at Hezbollah. We were sloppy the first time, but maybe we could do it right the second time.
The reasonable hope is it'll be a terrible war. A lot of Lebanon is going to be destroyed. Personally, you know, of course, I hope the Hezbollah wins. They have the right to resist foreign occupation and destruction by vandals and marauders. One hopes that after the second war, some Israelis might be able to start rethinking and saying, you know what, this strategy doesn't work. You know, so like what de Gaulle did in Algeria. Took them a while, very bloody war. About now the estimates are 1.5 million Algerians were killed, about 6,000 French soldiers. But after a certain point, a government comes to the conclusion the force won't work. I don't think Israel has yet reached that conclusion. Its view is, give us another chance. Maybe, if they fail the second time, some of them will begin to say, I don't think this strategy is working anymore. And then we have to wait for that. As to your question was, basically your question is a very simple one. Was the state in any way legitimate to begin with? And, you know, the fact of the matter is back then, there were a lot of respected legal minds which said, well, the partition resolution violates the fundamental principle of self-determination. This was a unit, Palestine. Population was overwhelmingly Arab. They should have had the right to vote for independence, and partition was invalid. And there were many people who said that back then. I think the argument is probably right. As a matter of fact, I cannot see on its terms that the argument was wrong. I think the implication of your question, I agree with it. But I've reached a point in my life where I want to genuinely see some sort of progress. It's the occupation. It's 40 years now. And I've been sort of part of it for a quarter of a century. And I would like to live to see the day where those soldiers pack up and leave. And it's not going to be nirvana. It's not going to be a perfect world. It's pretty lousy in South Africa after the end of apartheid. That's why when you open up your morning paper, you hear the poor are killing foreign workers. And then you read that the distribution of wealth is actually worse now than it was during the apartheid years. But does that mean the defeat of the end of apartheid was meaningless? No, I think it was a great moment. I really do. The notion that Nelson Mandela would end up being elected president of that country, in some respects, it's kind of breathtaking. But does that mean it's perfect? Of course not. And nobody's saying it's perfect if the occupation ends. But will it represent a victory for what's just and what's true? Yeah, I think it will. And maybe it's boring, and maybe it's uninteresting now. But if that day ever comes to pass, I certainly will be very glad to see it. Thank you.
I think I really exhausted you. And then, back to your mom. If you'd like to sit there, please wait for a few minutes. There's an important announcement. I mean, this meeting is organized by the International Socialist, and Norman was invited by Nibi. Important announcement, first of all, is if you want to read more about the issue of Palestine, Israel, Nakba, the ideas of Norman and politics in the Middle East, there's a very good magazine, it's in Dutch, Zelzen, Quartaalblad, toch? Half jaar? Minder? Beetje per jaar? Neem een abonnement. En er is een maandblad, de Socialist. Vandaag hebben we een lang interview gehad met Norman Mol. Volgende maand komt een uitgebreid stuk in de Socialist. Met wat we vandaag hebben gesproken nog veel meer. En de laatste mededeling voor Carmen van de IS. Carmen is one of the activists, like the guy there. who are every day fighting against Islamophobia in Holland, and I think do have the right to be critical towards Israel. The word is for Carmen.
Ja, well, ik doe het even zonder microfoon. Dit was volgens mij een heel erg interessante bijeenkomst. We gaan volgende maand weer net zoiets organiseren met een andere gast, namelijk Peter Gilligan. En Peter Gilligan, die naam zegt hier als het goed is waarschijnlijk helemaal niks, maar hij is een Amerikaanse... James Gilligan, sorry. James Gilligan, die zegt jullie misschien wel. James Gilligan. Hij is als soldaat niet alleen in Irak geweest, maar ook in Afghanistan en ook in Guantanamo Bay. En hij is ondertussen als veteraan aangesloten bij de organisatie Iraqi Veterans Against the War. Een organisatie van veteranen die zich inzetten om een eind te maken aan de oorlog. En hij komt vertellen over zijn ervaringen in Afghanistan, in Irak en in Guantanamo Bay. De bijeenkomst, de zaal is nog niet helemaal geregeld. Maar het wordt in ieder geval 25 juni, ergens hier in de buurt van de UvA. Als je op de hoogte gehouden wil worden, kom even naar mij toe. Laat even je naam, e-mailadres, telefoonnummer achter. Dan krijg je van mij dan krijg je een mailtje met hoe en wat precies.
Mag ik nog één vraag van Norman?